sign sheet was the when there's that sign sheet, like I said, it's sort of make sure you it's everybody's name card on the roster, and then make sure you mark Mr. Name, because well, you can write your name on the roster sheet, but we'll need that to take it to the end times. Make the final roster after next week. At least this hasn't been a class, you decided other people will be dropped, so put them in directly. But you can do this this week. That's the last line. Today we're gonna keep going with the supply and demand, like we started with one last time. Back in with graphics and finding equilibrium both graphically and with some algebra. Talking about what happens when we're not on equilibrium and what things would push us off equilibrium when we get back to equilibrium. And yeah, both graphically and algebraically. What I wanted to start with was just covering this idea of demand curve really well so that you're not just seeing like a line on a piece of paper. Like, how do we think about a demand curve? That there's like people behind it, and there's dollars behind it, and there's goods and services behind it, and then there could be environmental benefits or something else behind it. So, the first element of what I have to talk about today is this demand curve like a chunky discrete thing that comes in blocks of people consuming amounts of different things? Or is it the smooth line that we just start with, like demand curve draw line? Or is it a mathematical equation? Can we see how to bring those together? The more that we can start to have some intuition behind what a demand curve is, the more that answering problems is and mentors about like, interpreting the curves will come to you. So it's like, what is this mathematical representation from reading it, and how is it related to different information? So last night I was talking about Yosemite, so I started with the idea of Yosemite bus tours. We're going to start out with a fire in the beginning. We can bring a fire in the beginning later. My idea was maybe there's a bus that could come to Telegraph and Bancroft and pick you guys up and take you to Yosemite for the day on the long weekend. That's what I was thinking of last weekend. So the packages you're buying, and they have a bus that's going to take you to and Yosemite there. Is anybody following how fires are going? Yeah? Over half the change. Let's go do that. Anybody else follow what it is? The big thing for people who live in Berkeley, California is the Berkeley family get worn down, so a lot of them go to their kids, so that's being destroyed. The water supply for the city of San Francisco is within the Yosemite and that's 65 and the Tennessee Reservoir. That was sort of the big one that we're going to cost like orders of magnitude more than the regular force for it. And, you know, from the college perspective, maybe fires, we're going to think fires in the National Park, California College, and maybe long-term. These forests will be healthier. So we had our bus tour on the schedule, but I had a few different prices for the bus tour, from $95 down to $45. I just made this thing up. We're going to stay with it for a while. Hopefully it's mildly realistic. I looked up how much a real bus tour costs, and it's about $150. So this is the student special bus tour this year. So at $95, only 100 people want to go. At $45, 400 people are going to sign up to go. So before we do this as a curve, let's look at these people as like a big chunk of people. Right? For the first step, for $95, 100 people are going to go. One way to think about that is how much money is going to get spent? $100 for 100 people buying $95 ticket would be $9,500. If we're at the end, we had 400 people buying tickets at $45 each, that would be $18,000 each spent. So we also think of this as like the total amount that's going to spend on bus services for bus company services. Now, if we look at this histogram of chunks of people and people don't have money, we can turn that into a line. That's our demand curve. We can put a line and call it a linear curve on top of it. Take the histogram away, this is the thing that we draw in the line, the demand curve. Price, quantity, sloping down. This one's probably not a slope to it, so I just made up the numbers. I just made them up in a way that seemed like reasonable chunks. But the way we're going to do it for the math is we need a straight line, like a mathematical line, which the computer can get us an approximation of what a line of a bus ticket those off would be. And then we'll know how to make a straight line out of 400 pounds. Your algebra, anybody else? Sigma on each side? Yeah, so you have to have a mathematical way to average that out. And maybe you'll have lots of data for regression analysis. So regression is like using linear algebra to find the most efficient way between the two dots that's in linear. But we need a lot of statistics in our linear algebra. So a lot of our algebra is actually finding the straight line and can make it come out in the chunky line. We have another schedule, and I was talking to bus drivers asking them how many buses would show up and how many people would get a ride. If the price was only 20, only 100 bus seats would be there, which if you suppose a bus would be 50 passengers, only 2 buses would show up if the price was 20. If the price was 95, then 8 buses would show up for 400 people. And they would be making, almost $40,000. So we have our histogram of the data, and it's like chunks of people filling bus seats and paying dollars for it, multiplying price times quantity, and we get money. And then we can put a line on top of that, and we can also look for how to have this smooth mathematical line that goes to the bus that we just started with. And that's going to be an approximation for this, using algebra to approximate the data that we have. So, this is how we started last week. We find the equilibrium number for this market by saying supply equals the demand at price. The price we're going to need is at $55. And if we go across from $55, we look at it, turns out that would be 300 bus trips, which I'm saying would be 6 buses of people full. So, this is just finding the schedules and matching up the numbers. That was my way to do it graphically. I was like, actually looking where the lines were, actually looking on the schedules where the numbers lined up. And of course, I needed my own data, so I could make sure that there was a nice clean point right across, because it was a nice even number of 300, simplicity. But if we use our linear approximations, if we use our algebra, these nice smooth lines that are fit between the data points, we would get numbers a little bit differently. We'll come back and solve this later, but just using here, what's the price of the price if we use these algebraic lines? We'll go up a little bit in quantity, we'll go down a little bit. Okay. So back to our idea of putting a fire, we're going to shift to the main curve. Fire, I was taught it, I see smoke. Anybody read about that, I guess, and how it started? It could be on pop rock farms, which is a big thing on national forest lands. And there's been repeated busts, huge busts in national forests up there in these towns, and they think that could be related to tougher border enforcement. Tougher border enforcement makes it harder to import marijuana from Mexico, making it more worthwhile to grow in California, even if you have to really live in the forest. So, interesting, like, trade-off of taking border enforcement and changing environmental impacts in California. start shipping at. Whereas people, the first 100 people before were willing to pay $95, now the first 100 people are only willing to pay $80. So the whole curve shifting down, the number of people showing up to go on the tour is less. And so we have new schedule numbers. And we see that graphically, our demand curve is shifting in. If we look again with our supply curve, we can see that we have a new equilibrium at lower point. We can use just looking at the curves and trying to figure out where our new equilibrium is, how many people actually travel at one place. So less people are willing to go, coin is going down, it looks like it's about somewhere around 250, 275, less people are going. And the price they're willing to pay is about, it's gone down from about 55 to somewhere, somewhere in the 40s, somewhere around $40. We'll get back to this solving it mathematically. But one thing that we need to look at is when we're out of equilibrium, and what are the things that make us out of equilibrium? We call it market clearing, because that's when we have enough people buying and enough people selling at the same quantities. Some of the things that might take us away from equilibrium would be a government intervention in the marketplace. A government intervention in the marketplace could be the order control, how many units could be sold, or price control, how much price they could sell it. So if we go back to Yosemite bus trips, what if there were just too many people going to Yosemite, and it's packed? If you guys have been there, maybe it is packed. And there's a lot of congestion, it's crowded, there's just too many roads. And everybody said, I don't have to. It's pretty crowded, right? It's quite a lot. That's the line that people point at the table, find the film. So that's not like it's just a simple natural experience. So if we had, for some reason, too many people were going to Yosemite, there's too much traffic, too much air pollution, or it became unsafe to have people up there because it was too crowded, we could say only a certain number of people could go, and we could decide this is how many people will get to go to Yosemite. So if you put more control in here, we could say there's only going to be 200 bus trips to Yosemite. And we'll have a strict cap, and nobody else will be letting in. So for that, the price that people are willing to pay will be much above the equilibrium price. And in this example, if they're only 200, the price that people would be willing to pay for bus trips would be 70. But most companies would have been willing to do it for just $30. Another way to think about this, interesting, is if the price had only been $30, people would be demanding over 400 trips. And if the bus companies knew that they were getting $70, they would be willing to supply over 350 trips. So the incentives of the bus company and the number of people demanding it are way out of whack, and that's why we're getting pushed towards equilibrium. Another way to think about it is who's going to get that money? So if it goes to capacity control, or who goes to Yosemite, in this example, it's just the bus company. When the bus company's getting $70 minus $30 times 200, so they're getting quite a bit of extra money above the supply curve. And what would be a fair way for us to allocate that, to figure that out if there was a quantity restriction like that? And who loses out? So in this example, there's 100 less people getting to go to Yosemite. And who are those people? Those are the people, the price was in between there. So that's unfair to those people. And how do we figure out who, how to mitigate what happens to those people and make it so that they're not just out of the picture? Another way to think about it on the other side would be like price control. What if we said, there's not enough people getting to Yosemite, we really need to get kids out there. We need to get them off their cell phones and off the ground and crowd the video games. We need more kids going up to Yosemite. We're going to make the price lower because not enough people are going. So we could introduce a price cap. $45 the bus company cannot charge more than $45. We can get more people out there, so we're going to make sure it's cheaper for them. We can make them supply at $45. If we put the price at $45, 400 people are going up. But the bus company is only going to want to supply 250 seats. They're only going to want to supply 5 buses, but there's 50 buses worth of people wanting to come. Remember that for the bus company, if they were going to supply 400 seats, they were going to want $95. There's a big wedge up here between what they think it's going to cost them to supply that much and how much money it has to supply right now. If the market just makes its equilibrium at the price of 45, then the quantity the bus company is going to supply is only 250 micro bus seats. So there's no less people going than there were before we introduced this price control. And bus company profits are down for sure. Less people are going to Yosemite, bus companies are eventually going to drop out of business because they're requiring to do that at less than the cost of production, less than the cost that it requires them to do that. And then what happens is there's going to be a scarcity of bus trips. There's not going to be enough supply at the price that people are going to show up on the corner to go on the bus. So 400 people are going to show up on the corner to get on the bus, and the bus company is only going to supply 250. What do we do with those 150 people? What happens? Should it be the first person gets there? So this is where you end up rationing. So people who get there 5 in the morning get there first. It's all about standing in line. Should we have some sort of raffle where people enter into a raffle to allocate who gets there? Or would there be some guy selling tickets for just a little bit more on the corner? Right? So I think we're all familiar with this. We're going to sports, going to concerts, trying to get into a musical. It's the same thing. There's a whole market of resellers where the price has been fixed previously, but the demand for people in the moment is different. So what those resellers are doing is they're inching the market back towards that equilibrium. Okay, so let's do this mathematically. Pretty simple. We probably learned this in middle school or early high school. The slope of a curve, y equals x plus b. That is the slope of the line. B is the intercept of the line. And we had data before the red line. That was just like the plot of the line that we had to plot people on the sidewalk. And then if we come up with a function, a mathematical function, that will approximate it, the quantity of x equals 500 minus 4 times the price. As we talked about, we can get this linearization mathematically using the computer. What would this look like if we wanted to get it even more accurately, even though it's a polynomial? We're not going to do this fast, but we want to do it in a complicated calculus, but anyway, there are probably a price squared term as well, price and price squared, which would get a curve to it. Here we have our supply curve. And conversation. This one, looking at a slide for random exchange transpose of air quality supply equals 5 times the price of supply. And this is polynomial domain second term, domain squared term. So, we need to solve this for price because the main we're going to find our right equilibrium is going to set the price as equal. We're also going to solve it for price for the simplicity of revenue. Because right, what we have now is Q as a function of B, but we want Y as a function of X. We want that B as a function of Q. So, air quality supplies, air quality demanded, 500 minus 4, there's price demanded. We can solve that for the price demanded on the left hand side. And we have this simple Y equals NX plus B equation. The slope, that's the demand curve, is negative. So, minus 0.25 here. And here's what would happen if quantity was 0, is 125. We can solve the same thing for the supply function. Air quality supplied equals 5 times price supplied. Solve that for price supplied, that's divided by 5. Our slope is positive, it's sloping upward. Because it's a supply curve, as price goes up, quantity goes up. And then the intercept is zero on the supply curve, so you don't get an origin. So we need to set the price as equal. We take the supply curve, 0.2, set it equal to the demand curve, 0.252, and the intercept 1.5, and we can solve that numerically, dividing out that the quantity supplied and quantity demanded are for the same. Once we have the quantity, we can solve for the price. We solve for the price using either the supply curve or the demand curve in this case, and the price will be 50 cents. So if we look back at our linear approximation, our beta, mean, beta, blue, and green curves, we solved it just with the itself, and so the order we solved it was 355. And so we have a linear approximation, we have 5,278, and a price of 50 cents. So we're close, we're pretty good guess, we don't have like exactly the curve, but we have, you know, pretty close within a few percentage points of, right now, what people's actual demand is. And another reason that we need the algebraic solution is we'll do other things where we're going to look at the volume on the lines. And if we want to calculate the volume on the lines in the linear areas, we have an algebraic straight line, would be much easier to do so, rather than trying to piece together different lines, we're just following it. So if we want, to have an area of different triangles and different squares, and so having this simple linearization is going to help us so much to get out is worth, you know, this little bit of accuracy overall. So, need to work through a little bit, thinking about what it's like to not be in equilibrium and how we would get to equilibrium. Equilibrium is sort of like the basic starting point for thinking about how we're going to make and solve things, so we need to know mathematically. But it's also because the thing that we observe in the market is we observe price and quantity, the ones that are not in equilibrium. A lot of times we don't observe the whole rest of the demand curve or the whole rest of the supply curve. We need to go and ask people what they would be willing to pay other points. But what we observe is the actual point at which people are actually making changes. We think that we have, you know, equilibrium is the believable equilibrium. We think that it's an open market where people can enter and leave, where consumers can enter and leave. That would be a fair market where everyone would have equal information about what's going on. People would have equal access to information about what the alternatives are. Firms would have equal access about what their competitors are doing. These are all things that can be evaluated there, but a whole bunch of assumptions that we need to make so we can believe that this equilibrium is the price of clarity and the combination of those two. So, just like some other points here. So, what if the price is 40? What if the price is 75? Somebody help me, what happens if the price is 40? The price is 40 down here. We have an excess demand. We have a lot more quantity being demanded than being supplied. So, what happens with excess demand? There's a shortage. Well, what happens? Like, what would be a way that a shortage would be addressed if it's not the crisis? Actually, the price would raise, right? But meantime, there's like the scalper line I talked about before. There's a main line, people will have the main line, or people will, like, you know, so even if you don't get there by any time they sold out, there was no, you have to make a couple more days, loans on the shelf again, which we call rationing. In World War II, they had ration books where you're buying to, you just, like, you're buying all the same ways to allocate, it wasn't allocated in the market. What about seats at the University of California that was rationed? Seats in this classroom that was rationed. The rations by when you go out to the class right now. The rations by what your major is. So we have scarce seats in this classroom. Some people are in, some people are out, and we have not even enough days of even though we're scared off, we have to do it. Okay, so what if the price is 75? We have excess supply, we have too much being produced, not being used up. So what happened there? So what happened to surplus, like somebody's friend,